dreamed I went to heaven.
Once again to Friday Night Live at 8:05. Our subject for the night is entitled 8 miles away from the goal. Now, welcome back, brother.
It's good to see you again.
Good evening.
You know, a week's far too long to go without doing something, getting together.
Yeah. Sometimes the phone is about the only way we can get together, given our current employment status and our time constraints. But maybe the Lord's plan, got a plan there to change some things pretty soon.
Yeah.
And we'll spend a little bit more time together. But until then, I'm thankful for our Friday nights together. This Friday night, we're going to do something a little different. And there are some interesting developments this past week that caused me to spend some time in some self-reflection. And I think that's a good thing to do. Mm-hmm. You know, it's important, in my opinion, from time to time to spend a little time reevaluating your life, your activities, people that you engage with on a regular basis. Mm-hmm. Sometimes you have to reevaluate that, especially when you're challenged. And I was challenged this week with some questions that I really needed to answer for myself. So I had to ask myself some questions, And I had to look to God for some answers as well. So I spent some time reflecting and praying. And there's an interesting scripture in the Bible that I always turn to when I really need to know what's going on inside of me, mm-hmm. around me, or in me. And it's Psalms 139, verse 23. Pretty popular verse, Rowdy. And it reads like this. Search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my thoughts. Mm-hmm. Verse 24, it says, see if there be any wicked way in me, mm-hmm. and lead me in the way everlasting. Mm-hmm. Now, obviously, God wouldn't have to look too far, Rowdy, to see what's in my heart. He's known me my entire life. Mm-hmm. He knows me better than I know myself. As a matter of fact, you're probably aware of this next scripture. Maybe you could share it with us.
Jeremiah 17:9, you know, states a fundamental and foundational truth about our reality, all of us, every single one of us. The heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Who can know it?
Interesting. The question at the end has always baffled me, because what's obviously implied is that you don't really know your own heart.
Right.
That I don't really know my own heart. So, in order for us to be searched out in such a way that we could even begin to comprehend or to understand what's really there in the dark,
right,
behind all the closed doors, behind all the secrets that we keep in our heart and in our mind, and even further than that, beyond that, what's really in our motivation. Because oftentimes, I think it's very difficult for us to understand what's motivating our activity,
mm-hmm.
what's motivating our thought process.
Right.
And so I think it's healthy to stop and take a look at that.
That's right.
Sometimes.
You know, that word stop is kind of what I'm contemplating right now as you're saying it. We, if we're not careful, we tend to act or rather react on impulse to things.
Yes.
And in that moment, in those moments of impulse, we tend to think we understand our motivation, when the truth is, if we would stop, just like you think, with a little bit of self-reflection, we might discern a little better exactly what it is that's motivating us to impact our to act on impulse.
Mm-hmm.
You're right. I make the mistake way too often.
Well, sometimes we have to have something happen that will bring us to a place of self-reflection. And I had one of those experiences.
Mm-hmm.
And this week, my experience led me to basically ask two questions. And it wasn't initially me asking the questions of myself.
Mm-hmm.
It was other people who were interested to know that very thing.
Mm-hmm.
And I was very fortunate that I received a phone call from someone close to me. Sounds like we're being invaded by children, doesn't it?
I'm going to beat a bunch of little kids. Should I go do that now?
No.
Okay.
But are they still marching through the house?
They're gone.
Okay.
They snuck into your candy. That's why they're acting wild.
My candy?
Yeah, the stuff I gave you.
Yeah, not the way I remember the story, but anyhow.
Did you start yet?
Yes, we have.
Yes.
Keep the children away, please. Thank you. It's my daughter, Hadassah. Anyhow, maybe we'll get control of this video in just a second, Rowdy. I don't know. Or maybe we'll just have visitors pop in and hug and kiss us. Either way, works out fine. Anyhow, it was brought to my attention that there are people that have some questions, and they're legit. They're legitimate questions. You know, oftentimes we demonstrate to others some lack of judgment or character. Mm-hmm. Something inside of ourselves that's lacking. Mm-hmm. And people see us when we make mistakes or when we have a lapse of judgment or what have you, whatever the situation might be, and they make judgments. Sometimes they may hear something that's completely unfounded. Mm-hmm. They may just hear a rumor. Not backed up by evidence or fact, but a simple accusation from a stranger will basically stay in someone's mind forever. I mean, you can demonstrate that something's not true by living a good life and setting a good example. But if an accusation's made and that accusation lands in the mind of a person, they will question, inevitably, is this true? Is this a reasonable accusation? Mm-hmm. Is it possible that this man or woman could possibly have erred or be flawed in this particular area in their life? Mm-hmm. And, you know, in the day and age that we live in, that's not an unreasonable question for people to ask, because if you look at the world at large, if you look around us, how many scandals have we seen?
Yeah, it seems nonstop.
Politicians, bishops, clergy, priests, cardinals, mm-hmm. people in respectable positions, clergymen, mm-hmm. pastors, that have been convicted of pedophilia, mm-hmm. murder, and some of the most heinous crimes that you can contrive of.
Yeah.
So in the world that we live in today, we see so many horrible things going on in the world around us from people that we've been conditioned to a degree to look up to, respect, and trust, that if someone brings an accusation against some simpleton, some nobody like me or you, then you have to kind of step back and think this through. Mm-hmm. Could that guy or could that woman be capable of imperfection? Mm-hmm. Could they be capable of sin?
Right.
So I think it's a valid question. The second question that was posed that is also a legitimate question is this. That brother Danny gets on YouTube and Facebook every week and has discussions about the Bible and spiritual things. Mm-hmm. We see some evidence, or at least we believe that there's evidence, that guy isn't as good as we have believed that he was. Mm-hmm. He may be guilty of doing something wrong. Mm-hmm. He may be a sinner. What business does he have live on Friday night or on YouTube posting religious content? Mm-hmm. So those are two valid questions. I had to spend some time contemplating and praying about those questions this week. And so there's a couple things that came to mind. Rowdy, this is another scripture that you're going to be pretty familiar with. But it may be new to some of our listeners, so I want to share it with them. It comes from Romans. This is the Apostle Paul and he's writing this epistle to the Romans, and he says that the carnal mind is enmity against God, and it's not subject to the law of God, neither indeed can be. So in other words, the apostle is telling us that, Rowdy, there's something wrong with Danny's nature. Mm-hmm. Naturally, just the way he was born, subject to the curse. Mm-hmm. Adam and Eve, they ate the fruit. The curse came upon mankind. And all of their children after them have suffered from this curse. Danny is a recipient of that curse. And according to Danny's nature, the carnal heart is at enmity against God. Mm-hmm. Explain that word enmity for someone that may not be familiar with it.
In opposition to, opposed to, not in harmony with.
Right.
Antagonistic towards.
Thank you. So in other words, our natural mind, without supernatural intervention, is inclined to be in opposition to God's law. To do things contrary to God's law.
Right.
So let's look at some of God's law. Commandment number one. You'll have no other gods before me.
Broken that one.
Yeah, I thought about this for a little while. Danny, have you ever put other gods before God? And the answer is that I have often, throughout my life, exalted my own perception, mm-hmm. my own desire, my own opinion above that which God has delivered to me. In other words, I've always been aware since being a young child that there was a God, mm-hmm. that God had laws and standards which he wanted me to live up to keep, mm-hmm. that there was a standard of obedience. And I was also, well, where'd that come from?
Something's ringing somewhere. It's not me.
The center phone?
Yeah, one of our cameras is ringing. Phenomenal.
Hmm.
Interesting. So, yeah. So, in that, I've basically exalted myself and my opinion and my prerogative mm-hmm. over that of God's. I have essentially put other gods before him.
Yeah. You know, what comes to mind as I think about this, you know, he desires to be the primary influence in our life. So he's asking us, have no one before me, let me be the primary influence in your life. Mm-hmm. And we have spent, unfortunately, a great deal of our life not only not allowing him to be the primary influence, but being a counter influence in the lives of others. Not allowing him to be the primary influence, but by our actions, by our conversations, we influence people. And we become a god, in a sense, to others.
That's right. We've certainly, at the very least, exalted our own prerogatives over his.
Sure have. Yeah.
So you're in essence, you're putting yourself into his throne, into his mm-hmm. position, mm-hmm. even if it's just in your own life.
Right.
And you've, in essence, in doing so, you're putting something before him. Mm-hmm. You're putting self mm-hmm. before him. So I would have to confess that I have absolutely broken commandment number one. So commandment number two was a little bit harder for me to break down in my mind. It says that you shall make unto yourself, that you should not make unto yourself any carved images of anything that is on the earth or underneath the earth. You shall not bow down to them or serve them. So, had to focus on this one for a moment, because I'm not sure that I've ever made a graven image, but I tell you what I have done, what I know that I've done, is starting at a very young age, actually, purchased this box, and I set it up in a particular spot in the house. Then I took all the chairs that we have in the house, and I circled them in a very precise way around this box. And the box constantly portrays images. And much of the content and information that is being broadcast or disseminated by the box is actually contrary to God's design in our lives.
Right.
Or His intent. And just as you and I have pointed out in previous discussions, by beholding, you become changed from glory to glory, or from character to character, from whatever character you are to the character of that thing to which you are consuming, to which you are beholding. So, in essence, we in modern society kind of have these graven images that we're constantly bombarding our mind with. And whatever that content is then transferred into our mind and begins to transform it into the character of the content that we ingest. So I think I'm also guilty, Rowdy, of making graven images and basically giving them such respect and honor, giving them so much of my time and
devotion,
that it would basically qualify as worship.
Right.
As graven image worship.
You know, coming up on almost a year ago, when we did our first video, that very first series was on the idea of idol worship and false gods and images. And remember, we drew a spiritual parallel that you don't necessarily have to have just a literal idol to worship. As you're saying, it can be a TV, it can be a relationship. But as we pointed out in that initial series of videos, that we can hold wrong ideas about God. And the problem with idols in that day is they represented gods to which they had worshiped, but all of those gods had characteristics. And the primary issue with idol worship at that time was that in that idol worship, you're worshiping ideas and concepts about a God that doesn't exist.
Right.
And we can also hold wrong ideas about God. And in a sense, it's the same type of idol worship.
I agree. And you know, I think there have been times in my life in the past where that was certainly the case.
Mm-hmm.
And most of that wrong idea or thinking in respect to God
plays itself out in how you live your life.
Certainly does, but it's also a product of neglect. In other words, mm-hmm. I have always had one of these in my home.
Mm-hmm.
I'm very fortunate and blessed, and I thank God that I grew up in a country and in a family that had at least enough resource to always have one of these.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I've passed out thousands of these all over the world.
Mm-hmm.
I've run campaigns
mm-hmm.
to purchase large numbers of these books in different languages that I've distributed far and wide. And many of you may be interested to know that most of the world does not have access,
right,
does not have one of these in their home, mm-hmm, or is unable to read it if they did have it. Mm-hmm. So I'm very fortunate and blessed that I grew up in a country, in a family, in a home where we always had one of these. So I had access to what's true about God. I just neglected it.
Yeah.
So the wrong ideas that I had for many years of my life concerning God was because I turned my attention completely away from ever looking at this, mm-hmm, and only spent time understanding God in relationship to what other people said about Him. Mm-hmm. And that's extremely dangerous. As a matter of fact, it's this very issue is going to partly play into me answering question number two. Because mm-hmm, question number one is, who is Danny Henson? What kind of man are you really, Danny? Who are you really? What are you really? The second part of the question that's been posed to me and that I've been compelled to ask myself is,
what gives you the right?
Well, what gives you the right?
What's your qualification?
What's your qualification? Hmm. For you, very possibly a hypocrite, to be on the internet, on Facebook, or on YouTube, talking about these things. So these two questions I have to answer. I have to answer them for myself. I have to answer for them, these questions, for those of you who may be asking the same question. Who are you, Danny? What kind of man are you really? And what business do you have being on the internet talking about spiritual things? Okay. So, according to Scripture, according to Paul, my heart's at enmity with God, and it's not subject to the law. We've looked at two already, and I have to say, I'm guilty, yeah, of the first two. Mm-hmm. What about number three? Mm-hmm. You shall not take the Lord your God's name in vain, for the Lord will not hold you guiltless who takes His name in vain. Mm-hmm. Now, unfortunately, I'm absolutely guilty of this one too, Rowdy, because I have, in a number of situations in my life, while claiming the title of Christian, uh-huh, acted unbecoming of a Christian. Uh-huh. Last week, you shared a testimony with us about how you got a little disturbed about something that was said by an IT professional, uh-huh, and that you decided that you were going to correct him. So there was an email exchange that you talked about that got pretty hot.
It did.
Pretty heated. So, you know, interestingly, I don't know how many times I've had those type of things happen, mm-hmm, to me, where I've got upset even with people I love, my wife, mm-hmm, and did not love her the way that the Lord has instructed me to. Mm-hmm. Did not deal with the negative situation appropriately. Mm-hmm. You know, when someone attacks you, or when someone disrespects you, or when someone insults you, there's a couple different ways you could handle it, Rowdy.
Right.
Obviously. You could defend yourself and exact vengeance. You could meet opposition with equal or greater opposition. That's not right.
No, it's not.
That's not the example that Christ set in His life.
That's right.
That's the wrong way to handle it. I have often handled it that way. Uh-huh. Here's a couple alternatives. And these alternatives were brought to my attention by someone who I love, who I trust and who was brave enough to call me and confront me personally and privately about some of these struggles, mm-hmm. that he was able to see in my life. And he called me on it. He said, "Brother, I love you, but I need to talk to you, and I need to point out a couple things that I think you can do better. Mm-hmm. I think if you'll allow the Lord to speak to your heart, I believe there could be healing and that you could become a better man in this particular area in your life." Mm-hmm. And he gave me this advice. When you're confronted with opposition, negativity, insult, disrespect, when those things happen to you, there's two things you can do in relationship to the person that you're in the relationship with that brings this negativity to your doorstep, okay? Two ways you can handle it. The best way is with humility, love, and kindness. Mm-hmm. Don't return evil for evil, the Bible says.
That's right.
Good for evil, right. Not evil for evil. That would be the right thing to do.
Right.
That would be the idea, the ideal situation.
Mm-hmm.
That's what I would like to conform to. God help me.
Mm-hmm.
There's a second way that's kind of a, in my mind, a moderate position, but he suggested this as well, and I think it's wise. If you can't say something good, remember when we were kids?
That's right.
What?
Say nothing at all.
Don't say nothing at all.
Amen.
If you can't say something nice, keep your mouth shut.
Our parents taught us this as kids.
Yeah.
You can, I could in the future, when confronted with opposition, simply close my mouth and walk away.
Mm-hmm.
Allow cooler heads to prevail.
Mm-hmm.
Give myself some time for the emotion to settle down.
Mm-hmm.
Because when we allow our emotions to control us, we often respond inappropriately or ignorantly,
mm-hmm.
and make a mountain out of a molehill.
Mm-hmm.
So this is the advice that I was given in respect to these things. And I was really excited, actually, to receive this counsel. You know, in a multitude of counselors, there is safety, the Bible tells us.
Right.
So this counsel immediately struck me as wisdom from God. And I was so happy to hear it, because for some reason, my mind hadn't simplified it in such a way. That's right. My wife's not a man. When I was young and a man would approach me with something disrespectful or, you know, whatever the case might be, initially my response was equal or greater force.
Mm-hmm.
Throw down my opposition. Be victorious over my opposition.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what I trained into myself over the years. Well, we don't have to handle it that way, and we're instructed not to.
Right.
When they persecuted Christ, when they slandered and insult and and smote him, he opened not his mouth.
That's right. He didn't resist. He didn't defend himself.
So unfortunately, for many years of my Christian experience, I have not represented in all of my actions, in my lifestyle, the honor of being bestowed with the name of Christ.
Mm-hmm.
So I would say that I have definitely broke commandment number 3.
Mm-hmm.
So what about commandment number 4? That's a pretty big one, and especially in our circle, our circle of faith. Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days you'll labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath to the Lord. Yeah, obviously I can't speak for Rowdy, but I have certainly broken this commandment in a multitude of ways, because there is a motivational, spiritual connection with the Sabbath. Why am I doing this on this day? And then there's the actual performance of keeping the Sabbath day holy by not working, by not doing things that detract from the solemnity of the day, which take your mind away from God and back onto self or your responsibilities.
Doing your own pleasure.
Or doing your own pleasures, yeah. So there's both sides of the element there on the Sabbath thing. You know, if you go to church Saturday morning and then go home Saturday evening and work on your farm for the rest of the day, you're breaking the Sabbath.
Sure.
Yeah. By performance.
Mm-hmm.
If you go home and engage in behavior that takes your mind away from God, and it could be recreational, and you would still be breaking the spirit of the day, the solemnity of the day, in a completely separate way.
I'm sorry. You know, you can go home and just be anxious for the Sabbath hours to pass because you want to get on with your own thing.
Oh, man, you remember when we were kids?
Couldn't wait.
Can't wait. The wrestling's on. Mm-hmm. Can't wait for the sun to go down so we could watch wrestling. Mm-hmm. That was a big thing when I was real small. Yeah, that's just as much breaking the Sabbath as it is for you to go out and work in the field all day long. So, I have to confess, I'm definitely a Sabbath breaker. Honor your father and your mother, that your days may be long upon the land that the Lord your God has given you. Oh, brother, my dad's right over there. He could probably throw some stories out pretty quickly that demonstrate just how disrespectful I was for so many years towards my parents.
If he were to give you a one-sentence synopsis of your childhood, you were a lousy son.
Horrible.
Would it be something like that?
I mean, if he was honest with himself, maybe he would compare me to some other people's kids. Mm-hmm. And not say that.
Yeah.
But if he really took an honest assessment of the rules that were laid out for me as a child and how often I advanced those rules instead of looking for a way to get around them, if he made an honest observation, of course, my mom's not here. My mom would be able to answer those questions a lot quicker because she had a keen eye for me was very, she wasn't slow about discovering the little tricks that I had up my sleeve growing up to try to flout the rules.
Yeah.
And so, there's no doubt in my mind, Rowdy, that I have been guilty of dishonor towards both my father and my mother on so many occasions in my life that, I'm not sure that I could even remember, to be honest. What about the you shall not murder? It's an interesting one. Murder.
You know, we're told that if you hate your brother without a cause, enmity against people is the spirit that leads to murder and makes you just as guilty of committing it as if you pull out a gun and shoot somebody.
So there's the act of actually committing violence on someone that ends with the death of that person. And then Christ illumined this topic just a little bit to help us to understand that simply hating your brother without a cause.
You know, we can go back to the idea of influence. If by our influence, it leads to the death or destruction eternally of somebody, that blood is on our hands.
Certainly
that
right.
Also is murder. If we don't rear our children the way we need to, and they go astray and they're lost, we murder our children. You know, we do it to ourselves. We, in so many self-destructive ways, we destroy ourselves. So, boy, that might be the easiest one to be guilty of.
Yeah, and I would confess to you and to our viewing audience that I am without a doubt guilty of murder. I spent many years of my life hating others. And have certainly been guilty of that, and had an opportunity to be of a good influence on some people, and did not fulfill my responsibility in that respect. And some of those people are dead today. Wow. And although I didn't physically take their life, the influence that I had in their life resulted in their life ending, and I'll never have an opportunity to have been a positive influence in those people's lives. They died in whatever condition they were in when they died, and there's nothing I could do to influence that human being. I'm thinking of one person very specifically. There's nothing I can do to change the evil influence that I had in his life, or the fact that I had plenty of opportunity to be of positive influence and failed. I'm guilty of murder. You shall not commit adultery. Where are we now? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Commandment number 7. You shall not commit adultery. What do you think about this one?
You know, there's three ways in which we're guilty. There's obviously the physical act of adultery. Obviously, that one is self-explanatory.
Sure.
But there are two spiritual ways which are equally as wrong. The first one would be, in a sense, kind of what we've already covered, in our wandering away from our Maker, in our turning from him as our husband. In a sense, this is kind of related to not taking the name of the Lord your God in vain. That's actually marriage language. When a woman takes another man's name, it's a change of name that takes place as a marriage union. So when we become joined to Christ, we become part of his bride. We take his name.
Yes.
And then we can spend the rest of our lives being unfaithful to him.
Yes.
As a spouse. And in that sense, we're taking his name in vain. And that's the primary meaning of that scripture. And this is how we come back to adultery. We spend our lives committing spiritual adultery against our Maker. And then the other one, obviously, is the one that Christ pointed out. Lustful thoughts and looks and desires and intent that shouldn't exist in our conduct, in our character, in our actions, or in our influence. So now this covers quite a broad range of things, Danny. And again, we would all be guilty of that on many, many levels.
Well, I confess, you're right. There, you brilliantly articulated adultery, because it is, you could basically break it down into three categories. You have the act of sexual adultery.
Mm-hmm.
You have the thought process, mm-hmm, lusting after someone else,
mm-hmm,
which is equally adultery.
Mm-hmm.
And then you have what God is really concerned about. The whole thing is symbolic,
mm-hmm,
of the relationship that God wants to have with us.
Yeah.
And when we set him aside and go our own way, we are committing adultery,
mm-hmm,
against God.
Mm-hmm.
So you're right. There's all three of those elements that are present.
Mm-hmm.
And to be quite honest with you, I'm guilty of basically all three at some time in my life or the other. I've been guilty of all three during some time in my life or the other. I'll be as vague as that. Mm-hmm. But guilty nonetheless.
Right.
Guilty nonetheless. What about thou shalt not steal? Mm-hmm. It's another interesting one if you pause and think about it for a minute.
Mm-hmm.
Because there's obviously just going up and robbing someone of their possessions.
Right.
Physically taking things that do not belong to you.
Right.
There's a couple more that I thought of as I contemplated this week. There is also this passage in Malachi that talks about tithes and offerings.
Mm-hmm.
If you're not returning tithes and offerings,
mm-hmm.
there's a reference to robbing God
mm-hmm.
of what belongs to Him.
Right.
So there's that issue in respect to stealing.
Mm-hmm.
But I also kind of see that there's one more element to it, and that's interesting in respect to the culture that we live in today. We're obligated to render unto Caesar the things that are Caesar's.
Mm-hmm.
But there's a lot of this thing happening where, as a culture, we're choosing by legislative fiat
mm-hmm.
to take money from one group
mm-hmm.
to try to help another group live more comfortably. And I would submit to you that that's also stealing.
Sure. Yeah.
If someone volunteers to give charity to help people, that's one thing.
Mm-hmm.
But if you force someone to provide money, even if it's for a good reason, even if it's for a good cause, that's still stealing. Mm-hmm. Obviously, I don't want to go in depth into all of the political implications in respect to that.
Mm-hmm.
But just the stealing as in respect to taking something that doesn't belong to me
mm-hmm.
or taking something from God that should have been reserved for Him.
Mm-hmm. Go ahead.
No, go right ahead.
I was going to say that there's also this interesting, consistent theme that we can find in Scripture where we steal God's glory when we don't give credit to Him for the things He's done, when we place ourselves in a position between Him and someone else, we are stealing His glory. Somewhere, somehow, someone decided to break these 10 commandments down into 4 that relate to our relationship with God and the last 6 our relationship with man. And I find that that's terribly inaccurate because the principles are spiritual principles that relate both to God and man.
Yes.
And in our life, by our influence, we steal God's glory. We steal the influence that He's attempting to have by taking that influence and that glory to ourselves.
Yes, or we steal His glory by misrepresenting Him.
Exactly right.
And
that's good. That's the thought I was looking for, and I'm glad you captured that.
When we do that, when we misrepresent God, and this is so common today in the world that we live in, that people in religious groups, whole church organizations,
yes,
are stealing God's glory by misrepresenting His glory.
That's right.
His character.
That's
His
right.
law.
That's right. You know what else we steal another way is, Danny, when we wreck our health, when He lays claim to us, He says, you are not your own, you are bought with a price. Therefore, glorify God in your body, which is His. So when we wreck our health and we're unable to serve Him and minister to others, we're stealing from Him. When we're not giving Him the time in the Sabbath, again, here we see the spiritual side, we're stealing time.
Yes.
We've already covered stealing money. You know, and it doesn't just come down to a monetary issue. Money, unfortunately, in this world is required for ministry. And so there are people that won't be ministered to because of your theft.
That's right. Yes.
We steal in more ways than we can even imagine.
It's true. And I have to confess, it's embarrassing, Rowdy.
Yeah.
It's humiliating. But I have to confess, commandment number 8, and probably more than one way, I'm definitely guilty of breaking that commandment. This is painful. I'm glad there's only 2 more. You shall not bear false witness against your neighbor. That's an interesting one. I would say that if you say something about your neighbor, which is basically all of mankind, everyone that's not you, that's your neighbor. If you say something that's untrue or that misrepresents the character of your neighbor, you are guilty of bearing false witness.
That's right. This kind of, in a sense, gets to the heart of this topic tonight. Because we sit amongst ourselves, we talk amongst ourselves, we backbite, we gossip, we sling mud, so to speak, amongst ourselves. And it doesn't have to even necessarily be over something that actually took place, slinging mud, bearing a false witness. Like you're saying, we can just sit and talk negatively about someone else, and we're bearing a witness against them.
Yes. True or false?
Whether true or false.
Yes. In a sense, because even if you say something about someone that's true as far as you see it.
Your perception.
Your perception is this person is pretentious. This person is... thinks that they're better than me. This person thinks they're holier than me. Whatever. You may perceive something about someone else that you believe to be true.
You know, there's a New Testament scripture specifically related to that particular idea. And it is evil surmising. In other words, you are surmising evil. You are imagining, anticipating, and applying evil intent to someone else's perceived intent. You might have no fact. You have nothing but ideas running through your mind where you are assuming evil intent. That is surmising evil. In other words, imagining evil where none possibly even exists, because you're judging their motivation, you're judging their intent, you're judging their thoughts and feelings, and you're making an assumption that evil exists.
Correct.
That's evil surmising.
Right.
Boy, I can't tell you how many times I've done that.
I'm certainly guilty. I have definitely, with no doubt in my mind, have I been guilty of bearing false witness against a neighbor. The last one, I'm so happy that it's the last one, Rowdy, to be quite honest with you. Because I don't know how much more self-abasement I could tolerate. But it goes on to say that ye shall not covet your neighbor's house, nor covet your neighbor's wife. In other words, don't desire and plot on things that do not belong to you. The things that do that have not been provided to you. Be content with the things that God has given you.
Yes. Danny, I have known people, you have probably known people, that are so desirous of a worldly type of recognition and glory and applause that they spend a significant amount of their time and effort and energy doing that thing that we call keeping up with the Joneses. Well, I've got to have houses. I've got to have cars. I need people to think highly of me. I need people to consider that my status and my greatness is far better than it currently is. So I'm going to try to have education. I'm trying to engage in a career where I can make money so that I can buy houses and have cars so that I feel like I'm fitting in with people above me in status and where maybe I can begin to rise up into their ranks and be recognized, and everyone beneath me will applaud me for the things that I now have and possess. And that's what I see there as well. We're coveting things, like you said, that aren't ours. We're not content with what we have, and we strive with all of our effort and energy, stealing time and all of these other things to be something greater than we are, because we're not happy with what we have, all for the sole purpose of recognition.
Yeah.
How many people have you known like that?
Well, myself and lots of other people. So it could also go back to that first commandment where you're putting other gods before him.
That's exactly
because right. You're exalting yourself. You're wanting to be exalted to an unnatural position, and you're willing to do anything to obtain it.
Yes.
You're coveting the things of this world in such a way that you're willing to sacrifice your time, your talents, all of your effort in gaining those things. Mm. And absolutely ignore the one that's deserving of your time and your talent and your attention. So, it's a dangerous one. It's extremely dangerous to covet.
Yes.
And I am certainly guilty of it. Mm-hmm. Because what it does is, once again, you're stealing even.
That's right.
All these commandments kind of start to blend into one after another.
If you've
because you're taking
one,
something that belongs to God, and you're giving it to some other venture.
That's right. You're familiar with the saying, we're familiar with that, that if you break one, you've broken them all. Isn't that what we read in the
New
Testament?
That's an interesting concept, Roddy. So what you're telling me is that there's not a hierarchy of sin?
There isn't. And every principle is somehow interlaced. When you murder, you're also stealing. You're taking life that doesn't belong to you, and you're taking the life that belongs to other people. So if I kill a man, I'm taking the life of a husband from a wife, the life of a father from a child, the life of a brother from a sister or another brother. So you're stealing.
You certainly are.
So there is a sense in which all of these commandments are really one commandment. And you can trace them to each other. When I murder, now you should not have any other gods before me. Only God can give life and take life. I'm doing that now myself.
More accurately, it basically boils down to two.
Mm-hmm.
Mm. Love God and love each other.
Mm-hmm. That's right. Love covers a multitude of sins.
Yeah. So, all right. Here they are, all 10 of them. And I have no choice but to confess that I'm guilty of all.
Yes. And not just in my past, but oftentimes, even recently, if not in actual literal practice, in spirit, I'm guilty. Within the last hours, days, weeks, and months.
Yes. I'm with you. I'm right along with you. So there's no doubt that Danny's guilty. There's no doubt of it.
Romans 3:23. Only Danny Henson has sinned and come short of the glory of God.
I think you missed the bright yellow, the red words with the bright yellow highlights.
I might be colorblind, and I just can't. Yeah, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God.
By the way, you were still right in the way that you quoted the verse the first time. Danny has sinned, and Danny has come short of the glory of God. And I appreciate it when people who come to me privately and personally with love in their heart that want to see me grow spiritually, physically, mentally. They want to see good things for me.
Right.
I really appreciate it when instances like one that I had this week where I'm approached in a loving, tender way, where there was no doubt in my mind that this was Jesus. This was Jesus coming to talk to me. This was Jesus coming to plead with me, to instruct me. And I really appreciate it when people with that spirit come to me and address issues in my life. I actually expect it from people who I love and trust, from other Christians who I love and trust. But I'm also cognizant of the fact that all Christians, even the one who came to me with the voice of Jesus today, not today, but this week, they've all sinned. They've all come short of God's glory. Wherefore, as by one man's sin entered in the world, and death by sin, and so death passed upon all men, for that all have sinned. The scriptures, Rowdy, the scripture is evident in regard to this thing. We are guilty. Who's guilty?
There's none righteous, all of us. We have all together become filthy. There is none that doeth good, not one.
You know, this is an interesting scripture because Romans 3:10, well, it says it right at the beginning of the verse. It says, as it is written.
Mm.
When you see that in the Bible, as it is written, that means you're going to find the next statement somewhere else in the Bible earlier. Which is exactly the case. Romans 3:10 says that none are righteous, no, not one. How many are righteous?
None.
Zero.
Absolutely no one.
Psalms goes into a little bit more detail, and it says that they have all gone aside. They are altogether become filthy. There's a little bit more dirt on that verse. Because we've all gone aside, we're all filthy. There is none that doeth good, no, not one.
You know what I just noticed here for the first time is that Scripture seems to be defining righteous as those that do good.
Yes.
Righteousness is right doing.
Obviously it is. You know, there's another scripture that comes to mind where Jesus was asked or was confronted and was involved in a conversation where he says, someone comes to him and says, good master. And he says, there's no one good but one. That is God. He was looking for acknowledgement in that man.
That's right.
Because the man had made this declaration, good master. He was recognizing that there was something good about the master. And he was right to say it.
That's right.
Jesus was fishing for something a little bit deeper by saying to the man, there's none good but one, and that's God. That's those with the divine influence.
Right.
That's who's really good. But what else is being said there? He's talking to Jewish leaders, the most religious people that were alive at the time. He's talking in the presence of his disciples who were living with him and following him and learning from him. But his testimony is nobody's good.
Right.
Zero. Goose egg. Nobody. It's interesting. It begs some self-investigation when you hear these words.
Right.
It should, at least, if nothing more, help us to put things in perspective in respect to how we judge others. It should, at bare minimum, help us to do that.
You know, it brings to remembrance, you know, he that is without sin, let him cast the first stone. And if we're keeping in mind what you're saying, that none of us are good, none of us have any business casting a stone, sitting in judgment on someone else.
I agree. I do, obviously. For example, if there's a group of people in my life who I give them room in my
circle,
of friends, mm-hmm. and I discover that they spend a considerable amount of time speaking negatively of me behind my back, and after learning this, I'm hurt by it. It obviously wouldn't make a lot of sense to continue inviting those people into my circle.
That's right.
Because you're arming them possibly mm-hmm. with the ability to criticize you yeah. more, mm-hmm. and then those rumors of the criticism mm-hmm. go around until eventually it comes back to you mm-hmm. and you find out about it, and then you're hurt again.
That's right.
And you start developing anger issues, anxiety towards those people. Mm-hmm. Sometimes you'll begin to hate them. Mm-hmm. You'll begin to hate other people.
Right.
When you've been instructed to love your neighbor and your enemies,
mm-hmm.
this is counterproductive.
That's right.
So obviously, if I was to learn that there are people in my life that have demonstrated that they will engage in behavior that ultimately could hurt me or hurt my family,
mm-hmm.
it wouldn't be wise to continue to associate myself
right.
with that group of people. Doesn't mean that I don't love them.
Mm-hmm.
Doesn't mean that I would not be warm in their presence.
Mm-hmm.
Doesn't mean that I couldn't continue to love them, and when I see them, to embrace them as brothers and sisters. But it just wouldn't be wise to make them a regular fixture in your home or in your life
right.
because of the prospect that has been demonstrated that they could bring negativity and harm.
Right.
Okay? So it requires a certain level of judgment
mm-hmm.
to say, I don't know that this person could have any positive influence in my life,
mm-hmm.
but this person... has demonstrated that he could definitely bring great harm to me.
Mm-hmm.
So I have to limit,
mm-hmm.
limit their influence
right.
in my personal life.
That's right.
So I don't believe that there's anything wrong with people being judgmental about circumstances and behavior.
Mm-hmm.
You have to examine people's behavior
mm-hmm.
so you know who you can bring close and who
yeah.
needs to be left at arm's length.
That's right.
That's a no-brainer.
Right.
What we're talking about, what Rowdy's talking about when we speak of judgment, is putting someone out of your life or treating someone badly or harboring ill will towards someone or hatred or anger or resentment or jealousy. towards someone else. Mm-hmm. Because you've decided to judge them thus, mm-hmm. this is a problem.
That's right.
Did you want to enumerate on
no,
that?
No, brother, you're right on there. We, as Christians, we are under no obligation. How do I want to say this? Somebody may look at us and find fault with us because we choose to distance ourselves from certain individuals for the reasons that you just articulated. If their presence is toxic, if it is damaging, if it is contentious, there is absolutely no biblical precedent that says that we are wrong to eliminate ourselves and to eliminate their presence in our life. In fact, it is the healthy and responsible thing to do.
Right.
And we are under no obligation to have contact and relationship with every single person. We are called to love them. We are called to pray for them. We are called to do good to them, but that doesn't mean we are obligated to have a close personal relationship with them, because some people you just can't have in your life.
Obviously. I agree completely. You know what I'm thinking? What's become obvious to me just in contemplating the scriptures that we've been looking at thus far is that we're all in a bit of trouble here.
Mm-hmm.
We are without hope unless somebody comes along to save us, Rowdy. One of my favorite, absolutely favorite promises in scripture is the one on the screen right now.
That's right. But to him who is able to keep you safe from stumbling.
Hallelujah.
And who is able to cause you to stand in the presence of his glory, free from blemish.
Wow.
And full of exultant joy. That tells us two things. That there is only one who is able to keep you and to maintain you and to preserve you in a right place with him.
Yes.
And without that influence, without him, you have no hope. Going on, Jude 125, the only God, our Savior, through Jesus Christ our Lord, be ascribed glory, majesty, might, and authority, as it was before all time, is now, and shall be to all ages. Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Danny, we are hopelessly, eternally guilty of breaking every commandment, either literally, figuratively, spiritually, and we have no hope unless God, who is a Savior, intervenes and exercises a power of love and grace in our life to restrain us. Without him, Danny, we have no restraint.
That's right.
And we are guilty.
You know, what I've noticed as we've been contemplating the scripture, the law of God, is that it becomes pretty obvious that the entire law of God is centered around relationship. Mm-hmm. In other words, how we relate to God or to our Creator and how we relate to each other, the created.
Mm-hmm.
And we're instructed how to do this right.
That's right.
Obviously, there's those Ten Commandments that say, do this and don't do that. And it's to help maintain and protect mm-hmm. those relationships.
That's right.
Both the relationship with God and the relationship with other.
That's right.
And I was contemplating that this week because of the scenario that's going on, you know, surrounding my life and my family. And it dawned on me that there's scripture that helps us to understand how to deal with each other.
That's right.
Rowdy, you've pointed this out during the Brett Kavanaugh ordeal when it was breaking in the news, and we did a video about that. And here's a couple scriptures, Old Testament and New, that gives us some advice.
Mm-hmm. One witness shall not rise up against a man for any iniquity or for any sin, in any sin that he sinneth. At the mouth of two witnesses or at the mouth of three witnesses shall the matter be established. And you're right, that's exactly what we saw. We saw one individual, female, making an accusation against a man, and just the accusation was so destructive in its influence and in its effect.
Didn't matter if it was true.
Didn't matter.
It still did its work.
That's right.
There was a great number of people in the entire country. Mm-hmm. That developed a hatred for this man.
That's right.
That wanted his career and his life destroyed.
Destroyed.
Because of an accusation, there was no witness. Not even one. Mm. Much less two or three. The Bible standard says in the mouth of two, or in the mouth of three witnesses, mm-hmm. may all things be established. It's the same thing in the New Testament, Rowdy. 2 Corinthians, mm-hmm. chapter 13. Mm-hmm. This is the third time I'm coming to you. Mm-hmm. Who's writing this? This is Paul to the Corinthians. Mm-hmm. He said, I'm coming to you for the third time. Obviously, something was going on in the church in Corinth. We know that that was the fact. Mm-hmm. So Paul's dealing with a problem in the church. And he's going there the third time to deal with this problem, Rowdy. Mm-hmm. And he's repeating himself. Mm-hmm. In the mouth of two or three witnesses shall every word be established.
Right.
In other words, hey, I'm not going to be accepting accusations that are leveled at somebody mm-hmm. by a single person.
That's right.
Without the proper evidence to establish it to be true.
That's right. Here's why we have a minimum of two or three. And why are we told that it has to be two or three? Because if you have just two, there is the potential that the story that they're going to put out is going to differ in details. And so you can't rely sometimes even on just two, because elements of the story aren't going to jive even between two. So now you need a third. You have to come to the point where at least two people are telling the same exact story for it to be even considered a remote possibility that there's truth. And if three fail to tell the exact same story, you bring in a fourth. And listen, you come to a point where, listen, none of your stories are jiving. That tells me that the story's false. That's why we can't have just one. We can't have just two sometimes, because the stories don't jive. Even with three sometimes, the stories don't jive.
Correct.
False witnesses.
Yes. So this element is so essential that not only is it laid forth in Scripture, but it has been adopted by most modern governmental systems as well.
That's right.
As a legal standard. Mm-hmm. But this is certainly God's standard. This is how God addresses this issue. Now, how are we to deal with each other? This may be the absolute most important principle found in Scripture. Mm-hmm. And it's not just a principle. It's Jesus Christ telling you what to do. In other words, you're being commanded to deal with your brethren in this particular, in this specific way.
Mm-hmm. If your brother acts wrongly towards you, go and point out his fault to him when only you and he are there. The very first element is that if there was a wrong done, Danny, we do nothing with it publicly. We try to contain it. We try to keep it as private and as quiet as possible for the protection of reputation. Jesus is all about protecting the reputation of people. We don't go broadcasting it. We don't go sowing it like seed. So that's the first element. Keeping our mouth shut and not tattling, not gossiping, not spreading it around.
You know, I can actually think of an example of a friend of ours. I won't mention his name. Mm-hmm. But he did something wrong many, many years ago. Something pretty serious, actually. He did something wrong, and some people found out about it. It became public. Because of the manner in which it became public, and the way that he was treated by people in the community as a result of it becoming public, he was so hurt, embarrassed, ashamed, and destroyed by the way it was handled that he left the church and renounced God altogether. Wow. So this was a Christian man who turned away from God and turned to a completely heathen lifestyle for many years. Now, I praise God that this person later in his life had some circumstances that turned him back to God. Mm-hmm. I thank God for that. But it looked for a very long time like that was an impossibility. Mm-hmm. And I would suggest that God gives us this advice about how to deal with each other, mm-hmm, to try to protect from that scenario becoming a reality.
That's right.
Many people will turn away from God because the way they're treated.
That's right.
Not because of anything God did to them.
That's right.
But because of the way people treated them.
Yeah.
People associated with God, mm-hmm, or with the church or with, you know, whatever, mm-hmm, with Christianity. Many people will turn away from it forever, mm-hmm, simply because of the way they're treated by other Christians.
Exactly right. That's right.
And we have to be very cognizant and careful and mature about the way that we treat each other, because that is a real possibility.
That's right.
You know, it just is. So,
going on. All right, let's finish that last verse. We didn't actually get to finish that.
Okay.
Let's go ahead and continue. Finish that, because the thought is great. So if you go to him in private, brother, and you have your conversation, and if he listens to you, if he's easily entreated, you've gained him. You've gained him. You've saved a life. You've rescued your brother.
Yes.
But then it goes on to say that if he won't hear you, you go again. You don't give up, Danny.
No.
You don't turn your back, and you don't resort to bad behavior. You know, you don't start gossiping. Well, I tried, and this flipping Yahoo just won't listen. You don't broadcast what he's done. You try again, and this time one or two go with you, that every word spoken may be attested by two or three witnesses.
There's the principle once again, the power of the witnesses.
That's right.
So if you're unable to go to your brother and say, listen, you did something in my humble opinion that's wrong. I witnessed you commit a sin. And I desire for you to abandon this behavior because I believe it's going to be damaging to you. Mm-hmm. I believe it's going to hurt you or hurt people that you love. Mm-hmm. And that this inevitably is going to be destructive to your life. And if there's anything I can do to help you to avoid this, mm-hmm, this is what my intention is, by contacting you and confronting you about this issue.
Mm-hmm.
if he says, I don't want to hear it. Mm-hmm. It's not true. I don't want to hear you. I don't want to talk about this. Then you have to maybe take a little bit of time, let the emotions calm down, grab another brother, and the two of you go and sit down and try to reason. Mm-hmm. See, God's very careful.
That's right.
In the way he deals with us. Yes. And he's instructed us to do exactly the same thing. Because if we don't, we're being equally as disobedient.
That's right.
So you've got a person, you think, at least you perceive that they've done something wrong. You feel the need to at least go and talk to them about it, mm-hmm. to see if it's true. If you don't do that, and if you don't do it the right way, mm-hmm. you're equally as guilty.
That's right. That's right. You know, a large part of the principle of this is that you're trying to protect reputation. You're trying to protect their standing in the communities, in the church, in their family, amongst their friends. You're part of this ministry is doing damage control. You're trying to cover the sin. You're trying to bring restoration and bring healing so that that person is saved and ultimately so that their reputation remains intact.
It's preserved.
It is exactly the opposite that takes place when you sit around and gossip, when you sit around and tattle, when you sit around in groups making accusations, you're destroying the entire principle.
Maliciously. Mm. Because the minute that you decide, I'm not going to just keep this to myself. Mm-hmm. I'm not going to bring it directly to the person who I have fault with. Mm-hmm. Instead, what I'm going to do is gather other people together and talk about this.
Yes.
I'm gonna open this up to the general public. Mm. That's malicious.
Exactly right.
That actually goes beyond not listening to what Jesus told you to do.
That's right.
It goes past disobedience.
That's right.
That's where it becomes malicious.
Exactly right. That's right.
Now, you're equally guilty.
That's right.
Now we have two guilty persons. The person that you believe has wronged you, mm-hmm. possibly guilty. Mm-hmm. You, mm-hmm. definitely
guilty.
Definitely guilty.
Yes.
It's problematic. So what is God's true desire? What is his desired goal in this?
This next principle, Danny, is fantastic because you can't separate them. Judge not, you will not be judged. Condemn not, you will not be condemned. Forgive, and you shall be forgiven. But if you do not forgive, neither will your Father, which is in heaven, forgive your trespasses.
Yeah, ultimately God's goal is for reconciliation.
That's right.
He wants relationships to be restored.
That's right.
He wants people to forgive each other, to work out their problems between each other, mm-hmm. for lives to be transformed, for everybody to get better.
That's right.
To experience healing together.
That's right.
To help each other along the way to healing. Because we're all sick.
That's right.
There are none righteous, right. Not even one.
That's right.
So God's desired goal is that we would forgive ourselves and forgive each other and work together in one positive direction, mm-hmm. which is towards healing.
That's
right. And restoration.
That's exactly right. There's an interesting scripture, 2 Corinthians 2:7. Here is the most important aspect of this idea of forgiveness. This is the one that most of us don't even recognize or pay attention to. Forgiveness isn't about what you do and making yourself feel better. Listen to this, Danny. So instead, you ought to forgive and comfort him, the wrongdoer. So you're forgiving him and you're comforting him, the wrongdoer, so that he will not be overwhelmed by excessive sorrow.
Wow.
So the primary purpose of forgiveness, as you're saying, is healing and restoration of the person that did the wrong. So in all of our action towards the person that did the wrong, Danny, it should be with the intent for them to be healed. Who cares how you feel? You might have been the person that was done wrong. According to the Bible, your only focus shouldn't be wallowing in, oh, gee, they did me wrong, or oh, I feel so bad, or oh, they did this to me. Your only and primary concern was, I'm going to go to them and forgive them, and I'm going to comfort them so that they are not overcome with grief and sorrow and guilt. It is the exact opposite that takes place when we spend all of our time in judgment and criticism and in gossip about what that person did to me, about what that person did. Shame on them. No, shame on us when we are so self-centered and concerned with how it affected me that we lose sight of the fact that it doesn't matter what they did to me. What I'm called to do is forgive them and comfort them for their salvation and benefit and healing.
Wow, that is so powerful. You know, there are so many broken people in the world. And one of our greatest responsibilities, as it has been pointed out by Christ, both in by his example and through his plain speech, we are our brother's keeper.
That's exactly
we do have a responsibility to try to encourage and lift up our brother from out of the ditch to be the good Samaritan.
That's right. That's right.
We're actually commanded to put forth some effort.
Exactly right.
For that purpose. Because he's already done it for us. That's now right. He wants us to do it for each other.
Yeah.
Everybody is hurting.
That's right.
Everybody is sick.
That's right.
There is none righteous, not one.
That's right.
And Jesus is showing us, he's teaching us, he's trying. Pray for your enemies. Mm-hmm. Pray for those who persecute you and despitefully use you. Mm. This is ridiculous in our mind. Yes. Because our carnal hearts are completely against this, Rowdy.
You know, we talked about a principle last time. Hurt people hurt people. Yeah. And that happens when we stay so focused on our hurt and how we have been done wrong that it prompts in us an impulse to lash out. And it keeps this painful cycle going generation after generation. And I'm not saying that it's easy to do, Danny. It is not easy to be cheated on. It is not easy to be crushed by a spouse, a boyfriend, a girlfriend. It's not easy to have parents that are supposed to love you, abuse you, and hurt you.
Yes.
As a child. It's not easy for someone that you trust to steal from you. Listen, it's not easy to do the right thing, but it's what we're called to do, to get over our own wallowing in the pain that was caused to us and get outside of ourselves to initiate the healing for them. Because you know what it does? It initiates the healing for us too.
Yes. That's
the reason why we don't heal, Danny, because we're so focused on us and our pain that if we would just get outside of our pain, if we would step outside of our pain, lose focus on what's been done to us and try to initiate healing for that person that did us wrong so that they can be better. It makes us better.
Yes. You know, that principle that you just articulated is also going to be part of the answer for the second question. Remember, there's two questions that I've posed to myself tonight. Two questions that I'm answering for myself. Danny Henson, who are you and what are you? And Danny Henson, what right do you have to be in front of these cameras talking about this book and quoting from this book?
That's right.
What right do you have?
Yeah.
So, you know, here's an interesting example. The Apostle Paul is without question probably the most influential person in the New Testament in respect to taking the gospel message to the world. And most of you know the story of how in his early years he was Saul. He was this guy who was very religious, very well educated, and very influential in the leadership of the church of that day. He was a Pharisee, a student of a man named Gamaliel, who was obviously someone of great import in Jerusalem, a highly respected theologian and teacher, and Paul was his student. So Paul was no slouch. Paul had skills. Paul was wise. He was so wise that he persecuted and cast his vote in favor of persecution to God's saints. He was responsible for holding the robes of the men that stoned Stephen to death. This is who Paul was. But we have this incredible story in Scripture of how Saul, was transformed into this character we know as the Apostle.
That's right.
Paul, the great Apostle. Mm. Did more to spread the gospel throughout Asia than any character in Scripture. A great evangelist. Okay? So this is who we're talking about. The famous, the renowned Apostle Paul.
The same.
Yeah. Wow.
So what was interesting to me is when you consider, based upon Paul himself, his own, in other words, Paul's own words, what Paul's evaluation was of himself. So if you read through the epistles, you will actually find what Paul's opinion was about himself, and it's very interesting. Notice initially in 1 Corinthians chapter 15 and verse 9, Rowdy Paul says, I am the least of the apostles and not fit to be called an apostle. Why? Because he persecuted the church of God. That's what Paul said about himself.
That's right.
There's a second statement, if you would share that with us.
Sure. To me, who am less than the least of all God's people, has this work been graciously entrusted to proclaim to the Gentiles the good news of the exhaustless wealth of Christ.
Wow.
So not only is he the least of the apostles and not even fit to be called an apostle, in his mind, he is also least than the less. He is less than the least of all God's people, and yet he's entrusted with a work to do for Christ.
That's amazing, because to be an apostle means you're of a high office. You are working directly for Christ. At this particular time in the church, apostle was the highest position to attain.
That's right.
And he's saying, I'm the least of the apostles. But he goes on to say something even worse about himself in the quote in Ephesians that you just read. Not only is he the least of the apostles and not even worthy to be named as one of them, he's also less than the least of all of God's people.
Right. That's right.
Wow. Notice 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 15. Paul says that this is a faithful saying. That's an interesting way to start to say what he's about to say next.
That's right.
This is a faithful saying and worthy of all acceptation that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am chief.
Wow. Wow.
Amazing. Oh, no.
You know, there's something else that he says that's interesting. So we're talking about our qualification to be engaged in ministry as incredibly fallen, broken, sinful people. And what we're seeing is that while we can never claim to be perfect or even good, we can claim to be held in check to a restraining influence when we submit to it that is able to keep us, although we quite often choose not to be restrained. Yet even in spite of that, we're told that while we're sinful, while we're broken, we have a work to do, Danny. And in this process, being confident of this very thing, that he which began a good work in you, he will perform it, he'll continue it until the day of Jesus Christ.
Praise the Lord.
I love that. So, Danny, what is your qualification as a sinful, failing, quite often embarrassing to yourself and to your God? What is your qualification? One thing. Jesus Christ and him crucified. That he's doing a work in us. And when the work fails, it's not a failure on his part. It's a failure on our part. But that doesn't relieve us of the duty to remain engaged and keep on striving.
You know, it's interesting, Paul's confessions, I'm the least of the apostles, I'm not worthy to even be called an apostle. As a matter of fact, I'm less than the least of all of God's people. As a matter of fact, I'm the chief of sinners.
Yes.
That was Paul's confession.
That's right.
And I'm going to give Paul his confession. But Paul's dead. So today, May 24th, 2019, I have a confession to make to you. I am the least of the apostles. I'm not even worthy to be called an apostle, Rowdy. I'm not. As a matter of fact, I'm less than the least
of all God's people.
Of all God's people. Yeah. Danny Henson is less than the least.
Yeah.
And furthermore, at this stage of the game, it's quite possible that I am the chief of sinners.
Yes.
That is Danny Henson's answer to the question, who is Danny Henson?
Yes.
I am less than the least of all the saints. I'm the chief of sinners.
Yes.
That is my self-evaluation. As a matter of fact, I think I hope I've made that plain for the years that I have been working in missionary service.
Yes.
And have been doing videos mm-hmm. on the internet. I've told you, please never take my words for granted. Go and study to show thyself approved unto God. Test and see. Taste and see. These things I've instructed you to do. I've instructed you to never base your religious experience or knowledge on the words of another man.
Yes.
Certainly not this one.
Yes.
That would be foolishness. And I have warned you against it every step of the way. So, there's the answer to question number one.
Yes.
What about the second question?
Danny, this is a great scripture here. This gives me comfort and hope. This quite often, I can identify with this. Danny, here we have an event that just took place, remember? And it was kind of disturbing to the disciples, to many of his followers at the time.
Yes.
And he had made a very strong statement, you remember. You know, he had fed the multitudes on two different occasions in Scripture, and he comes along and he makes a statement, and he says, you know, unless you eat my body and drink my blood, you know, you'll have no real connection with me, you'll have no real life, you can't be of me, essentially. And that caused quite a stir among those who were following him.
Much confusion.
That's right. And because of that, many who had been following him up to that point ceased to walk with him. And so now what we have are his 12 and probably some others. And bear in mind that these are still very unconverted individuals. They are selfish. They're contentious amongst themselves. They are judgmental and critical still. They're condemning and were so selfish and unconverted at this point that this story is taking place. Keep this in mind. They are unconverted. They are sinful. They are selfish. They're a mess, Danny.
They're fighting with each other over positions of grandeur in his kingdom.
Yeah. Wanting to call down fire.
And murder whole villages.
And murder whole villages. So these are the apostles.
The apostles.
At the time that this is taking place.
Yes.
And listen to this, Danny. This is what rings with me, and I'm sure it's what rings with you. From this time, many of his disciples turned back and no longer would walk with him. And then Jesus says to the 12, do you also want to go away? Have you found me unappealing and undesirable? Have you found some fault in me that has turned you off? And listen to what Peter says. Lord, to whom shall we go? Where else would we go, Lord? What else would we do?
Yes.
There is nothing else that would be appealing, that would be attractive to us, because there's still something that you possess that we want. You have the words of eternal life.
Hallelujah.
We also have come to believe and know that you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. So, Danny, listen. When I'm contentious, when I'm hateful, when I'm mean-spirited, when I'm selfish, when I'm wrapped up with myself and making all kinds of mistakes, what I'm thinking wrong and doing wrong and feeling wrong and behaving wrong, I can confess that, yet at the same time confess this one thing. I don't want to go anyplace else. Because what I have recognized and what I have seen is enough to turn me back and keep me focused and hopefully continuing to make progress in spite of how screwed up I am. That is why we do what we do.
You have very accurately articulated my answer to those who would question, Danny, what right do you have? You have told us tonight, you have confessed that you have broken every commandment that God has written. And they're right.
Yes.
I have confessed to you. I've broken every single commandment. I am absolutely guilty. I'm not worthy to be called an apostle. I'm less than the least of all of God's people. I'm the chief of sinners.
Yes.
Danny, what do you have? What makes you think you have the right? Where else can I go? I have heard Jesus. I've heard his words. They have spoke to me deep into my heart. They have spoke to me. I believe that he forgives me. I actually believe it. I believe that he died to save me.
Yes.
I have seen him, and what I've seen is so beautiful that, and he did it all before I cared anything about him, before I even considered him. He did this thing for me.
Yes.
While I was his enemy, he did it for me.
That's right.
And I believe it. There's a couple of scriptures that came to mind, and I wrote them down. I didn't write them down. I copied and pasted them into a PowerPoint presentation. But the love of Christ, it compels us,
that's
Rowdy.
Right. That's right.
We have concluded this, that one died for all, and because of that, we've all died. He died for all so that they should live, should no longer live for themselves, but live for the one. The one I'm talking about is the one who died.
That's right.
The one who rose again.
Yes. The Christ, the Son of God.
Exactly right. I'm sorry, folks. But I can't help but speak of him.
Yes.
The love that he's demonstrated towards me compels me.
That's right.
Secondly, I have witnessed pastor, preacher, priest, and prophet say things about him that are contrary to the things that he has said. And I feel obligated to stand in defense of him because he hung in defense of me.
Yes.
So I will defend his word. I will defend his character. I have to. I'm compelled. Now, maybe I don't love him enough because I fail him. But I am confident of that very thing.
Yes.
That he who has begun a good work in me will perform it. He'll complete it. That's He'll right. finish it. He'll bring it through. Hebrews chapter 2.
How shall we escape if we neglect so great a salvation, which in the beginning was spoken by the Lord and was confirmed to us by those who heard? God also bearing witness, both with signs and wonders, with various miracles and gifts of the Holy Spirit, according to his own will.
It's a very important scripture. how should we escape destruction, Rowdy, if we neglect so great a salvation?
That's right.
Is it possible for us to neglect it? Yes. Have I neglected it?
Sure.
Yes, I have. Guilty. Uh-huh. But I believe that the potter, uh-huh. you know, Christ is described in Scripture as a potter. Uh-huh. I took an art class in high school, and we used the pottery wheels uh-huh. and the clay and the water to create vessels. Uh-huh. And the Bible describes, as in a metaphoric sense, that Christ is a potter, that he can create a vessel that he could then fill with his own influence, with his own spirit,
yes.
in such a way to make that a fit vessel, a work of art,
yes.
a masterpiece.
Yes.
I believe that he's able to do that.
Yes.
Do I believe in Christian perfection? You better believe it.
Mm-hmm.
I'm an advocate of it. I am not an example
of it,
but I am an advocate, and I can believe that he can do that for me. I believe that he can do it in me.
Yes.
Will I let him? Different story. I don't know. I have absolutely no confidence in myself. None.
Yes.
But I have all the confidence in the world. Of this, I'm confident that he who has begun a good work within you and me will go on to perfect it in preparation for the day of Jesus Christ.
You know, this tells us something pretty fantastic, Danny, that while Paul understood his reality, that not only was he far from perfect, but that he fell so short in so many ways. And yet, he's engaged in ministry, doing the best he can, because he's confident that the one who started the work will continue to make it happen. Paul realized that, you know what, I'm not perfect, and I do make mistakes, but I still have to engage in ministry. My qualification for ministry isn't because I'm perfect. My qualification for ministry is because I'm imperfect, and there's a God who's able and who is currently attempting to hold me and restrain me and heal me, and he calls me to the ministry of helping others be healed and helping others be made whole. And that's every one of us. That's you and that's me.
Rowdy, I'm in complete agreement. I'm compelled to do the same, and will continue to do the same. You know, I started off this discussion tonight with a title slide. 8 miles from where I want to be, or 8 miles from where I need to be. Obviously, it was a play on the 8 Mile theme. Yeah. 8 Mile was a movie that was put out several years ago. When I was in high school, I was a connoisseur of music. You know, there were several different genres of music that I enjoyed, but one that was very popular in the last few years of school was rap. And there was this young white guy that was making us all proud at the time, that came, sprung onto the rap scene. He was brought into the game by a guy named Dr. Dre, who was another big-time player in the rap game, okay? So Eminem was brought onto the scene, and he came out with tremendous talent uh-huh. and to much fanfare,
uh-huh.
okay? Also quite vulgar.
Uh-huh.
Unfortunately, but they decided, Hollywood did, that this kid's story was so interesting that they would make a movie about it. Mm-hmm. So they came out with this movie that was called 8 Mile, okay? And it basically told this rags-to-riches story of this kid from 8 Mile. And is that Cleveland or Cincinnati? I can't remember.
I don't know.
It's in Ohio, one of the major. It's either Cleveland or Cincinnati, if my memory serves me right. There's an area in town, a road, called 8 Mile. I've actually drove down it. And he was born in that area. That's where he's from. And it's a low-rent side of town, okay? It's and for him, being a white guy, he was basically trailer park trash, or what's referred to in such language, okay? Came from poverty, from bad parental guidance, mm-hmm. all of that. So this story is almost an autobiography that's played out in this Hollywood movie, okay? So it goes through his rough life and his sad circumstance. A mother with addiction problems and a little sister that's not being cared for properly and abusive relationships and mm-hmm. friends that are untrustworthy, mm-hmm. Friends that are trying to be big shots that are not. His life's a joke in a lot of ways, mm-hmm. but he's tremendously talented in this art form known as rap. Mm-hmm. Okay. So he's battling his way, and when I say battle, he's entering into these competitions where rappers battle against one another. And the idea is to insult the other person in such a dynamic and artistic way, verbally, mm-hmm. to a beat, mm-hmm. to a rap beat, that your art is clearly better, superior to the other guy. Mm-hmm. Okay? So he's engaging in these battles. And he's got all this drama in his personal life. So you get to the end of the movie, and the climax of the movie brings us to this battle. And Eminem is going to battle the best rapper in the city. The guy who's at the top of his game. Respected by everyone. So they're at this place, this venue, thank you, which is basically like a nightclub situation, mm-hmm. where all these people are gathered to see this big event. Eminem against the boss man, you know, the rap champion, the battle champion. So they're on stage together, and there's a coin toss. The moderator comes out, and they flip a coin, just like in a sporting event, to see who's going to go first. Obviously, the main man, you know, the top dog, wins the coin toss. Mm-hmm. He gets to pick. And he does what any smart battle rapper would do. He allows Eminem to go first. Because mm-hmm. he's going to listen to what Eminem says, and then he's going to come back, mm-hmm. you know, and respond. So going second is advantageous, uh-huh. right? So they hand the mic to Eminem. So Eminem's standing there. This guy's obviously very talented, comes from a better home, uh-huh. better family, a better financial situation. Uh-huh. He's got lots of friends, uh-huh. tons of respect, uh-huh. nice cars, lives in a nice home, in a nice neighborhood, attended nice schools. Eminem, trailer park trash. So the music starts to play. They're expecting Eminem to begin battling. But he just stands there silently, holding the mic, staring his opposition in the eye. And the music plays, and the music plays. And all of a sudden, Eminem begins to battle. He confronts his enemy, And then he begins to confess everything about himself. You're right. I do have ridiculous friends that are unfaithful to me. Yes, my girl's running around cheating on me. Yes, I'm trailer park trash. You're right. My mother's an alcoholic. I don't even know my dad. I went to terrible schools. We have no money. I live in a single wide trailer. You're right. I'm all these things. I'm garbage. I'm nothing. I'm trash. Now what else have you got to say about me? And he throws the guy the mic. And he walks away. The guy is left speechless. There's nothing else to say. Eminem has already laid everything out bare. As I was contemplating and self-reflecting this week, I realized that I was Eminem. I was nobody. I was nothing. I was a sinner saved by grace alone. That I'm not worthy to be called an apostle. As a matter of fact, I'm less than the least of all of God's people. And I probably hold the title as the chief of sinners.
Yeah. And there's nothing anyone can say to you or about you behind your back that is going to be any more true than what you've already confessed to.
What are you going to say about me? Yeah.
What can you say?
That I haven't already said about myself. So if you're confused about who, if you were confused about who Danny Henson is before tonight, I hope you're now clear who Danny Henson is. This video and others like it are not about me. I've never asked someone to obey me, or to worship me, or to respect me, or to exalt me. I've challenged you to oppose the truths that we've talked about, the evidence that we've presented. If you could bring better evidence, then I'll be convinced. If you come to me and say, "Hey, Brother Danny, I don't like you," or I was hurt by you, or you've done something that has wronged me, I am prepared to humble myself, to sincerely apologize, and to ask for forgiveness. Because I want to be reconciled, even with my enemies. And I've proven it by traveling into places where the people very likely would like to murder me. To prove to them that I love them and I want reconciliation with them.
Yes.
I've done it for a fact. That's who I am. I have nothing to boast on. My righteousness is in the dirt. I have nothing but filthy rags to offer. That's all I've got. Yeah. Only thing I have, the only hope I have, is the blood of Jesus Christ. By the way, the only hope you have,
yes,
is the blood of Jesus Christ. Because there's none righteous. You may think that you are. As a matter of fact, the minute someone begins to describe themselves as such, I would warn you to move far away.
Yes.
Rowdy, any final words?
Not at all, brother. You've covered it wonderfully and made the points clear and made the case plain. And I agree with you 100%. This is your condition. This is my condition. Collectively, this is our condition. God help us.
God help us. Bless you all. Have a wonderful Sabbath. Once again, we encourage you, if you have any comments, any questions, any reactions, please message me here at Facebook or on YouTube, as this will be uploaded to YouTube immediately after our live program tonight. You can find us at YouTube at Danny Henson Jr. I'd love to change the name so it's not just my name. Maybe put, I'll try to figure it out, but we've got lots of videos there under my name, Danny Henson Jr. on YouTube. God bless you. Have a wonderful weekend. Happy Memorial Day. I'd like to thank all of the servicemen that have sacrificed their time, their talent, and many of them their lives in service of our country. Yes. Thank you so much, Rowdy, who is a serviceman who did fight active duty in Iraq. Thank you so much for your service, brother. I really appreciate you. My dad, who is a Marine, a former Marine as well. I just want to thank all of you so much. I also want to ask anyone that may be watching that may be from this area that grew up in the same town that I grew up in. A good friend of mine, one that I haven't been close to in several years because, of course, I've lived everywhere. Chad Duggan has had some medical challenges this week that are severe. And I would ask that all of you pray for my brother, Chad Duggan, as he's in the hospital fighting for his life. May God bless him. And I'd really encourage you, if you know him, even if you don't know him, please pray for my friend Chad Duggan this weekend. And thank you so much. God bless. Good night, everyone.
Streets of gold beside the crystal sea. We heard the angels singing, and someone called your name. We turned and saw this young man, and he was smiling as he came. And he said, "Friend, you may not know me now." And then he said, "But wait. You used to teach my Sunday school when I was only 8. Every week you would say a prayer before the class would start. And one day when you said that prayer, I asked Jesus in my heart. So glad you